Yes, thank you, Jura, and also want to thank the organizers, Theo and Jura. So they asked me to give a tutorial on the fundamentals of light-driven ultrafast spin dynamics in magnetic materials. And I thought to talk about two topics that are in the center of the attention today. It is one topic is all optical switching. And I want to go a little bit more into the theory that we can do for all optical switching using input from ab initio calculations. But then we have to go to multi-scale modeling because we have processes that happen on short time scales and on long time scales. So we have to bind them together with multi-scale theory. And then I want to go into the second topic that we also have heard several times now already today. Ultrafast laser-induced demagnetization. It is a topic that was a surprising discovery 20 years ago. And still we are discussing what is actually going on. And we have not reached the answer of it. So in this part, I want to go a little bit more into the fundamental mechanisms. Actually, Bert did an excellent introduction into that this morning. Okay, so let us look and go to all optical switching. And there was a foundational paper, that was the paper by Stancio et al., 2007, from the Nijmegen group, where they showed that if you have this gadolinium iron cobalt, it is actually, it was a material thought for magneto-optical recording. What you can do is you can write on the material with circularly polarized light. You see nicely here the domains, and with linearly polarized light you have a rather complicated domain formation. But the important point was you can optically write on the material, and they cleverly and in a good way, they understood in Nijmegen that this has much potential for applications, that in the future, if you can do this, you can go to hard disk technology and you can combine that. And if that works, one has to say, then we can go to much faster writing on hard disks in timescales that are picoseconds. And one has to compare that to the normal nanoseconds that you have if you have field-induced switch, magnetic field-induced switching nanoseconds. So you could potentially do this much faster. And Theo is not there at the moment, but he took time to explain to me that this is real data. So I always thought that this was some artificial picture, but it is real data that is in there. Okay, so that was a beautiful demonstration that you can write on the material, and then in that paper it was also addressed, at least mentioned what is the possible mechanism, and these mechanisms they have also been mentioned this morning. One possible mechanism is what is called the inverse Faraday effect. It is written in this way here. I have induced magnetization through a nonlinear magneto-optical effect, inverse Faraday effect. And what I can do is if I have the right or left circularly polarized light, I can impart magnetization in the material. And if I can do this in a good way, I can assist the switching. But for sure, that is not the only mechanism that we have, but certainly it is something that we need to take into account. However, what was shown not so long after that paper, that you can do toggle switching. So in this material, gadolinium iron cobalt, you have the effect that even you can switch with linearly polarized light. You can do one single pulse, you see switching, next pulse you switch back, and so on. So you have toggle switching. It works with linearly polarized light, which then means what is now the effect of the inverse Faraday effect. Basically, there is not a direct relation to this. What was done is that this was the experiment, actually, from Nijmegen and the PSI. And then there was atomistic simulation done by the group in York. And they could beautifully show with Landau Lifshitz Gilbert simulations that you can reproduce this. You give a heat pulse to the material, and then there is a certain important property that we have, that the iron and the gadolinium, they are very different. And that was also the topic of this paper in Nature of the Nijmegen group, that you have the, if you look, and now this is elements specific. So you with XMCD, you first pump the material, and then you measure with XMCD the iron, how the iron demagnetizes, and you can do the same thing from the gadolinium. And what happens is that the iron absorbs most of the energy, it demagnetizes, an important point is that the iron starts to remagnetize already, and in that point it can drag the gadolinium with it, but then actually drag with it means that it must go to the opposite direction. So this was thought to be very important, the transient ferromagnetic state. If you look into the simulation, actually there was not so much, but a little bit, transient magnetic state. Okay, so the gadolinium iron cobalt is special, and for this material we can have toggle switching if we have just a heat pulse. But now, the next discovery by Stéphane Mangin. So actually there was first this paper in Nature Materials, where it was shown that you can do helicity, really now helicity dependent switching for a much wider class of materials. There were ferromagnets, there were synthetic anti-ferromagnets in this paper. And then there was, shortly after this paper, there was this paper here in Science, where it was shown, if I now take a ferromagnet, iron platinum, there was also cobalt platinum in that paper, but if you have that material, which is now a material that is really important for recording, you can also write with circularly polarized light on iron platinum. So it means that we have for gadolinium iron cobalt, we have helicity independent thermal switching. But if we go to this class of materials, iron platinum, it is different. Here the switching is really helicity dependent. Okay, so it still is the question, how does it now precisely happen that one can write on the material? And that is what where the theory needs to come in to do now really simulations and come with ab initio calculations and then have an explanation of what is seen in the experiment. So shortly after this paper by Lambert et al., Markus Münzenberg and collaborators started to do similar things. And a question is, so what Stefan was doing, that you have the circularly polarized light and you move it over the material. Now the question is, okay, how can we go to short pulses? How many pulses do we need to switch? Now, can we go to single pulse switching? Basically, that you have a long pulse, continuous laser, and you move it is not so convenient. You would like to have short single pulses. So that was first of all, I have to say that the group of Markus Münzenberg, that as was Markus saying this morning, they could perfectly reproduce these data, showing that you can precisely do this. Helicity-dependent switching, and then you can try to go to a few pulses, and you can try to see how many pulses do you need. Here, this was two pulses, and actually what you see is that there is the beginning of the formation of a contrast. So that is a magneto-optical image here. So it means then that it is possible to switch or to go in the direction of switching with a few pulses. The microscopic origin is still a big question. So we have the two mechanisms that were mentioned this morning. There is the helicity-dependent absorption. So this is the MCD, magnetic circular dichroism, that depending on the helicity, the material, ferromagnetic material, it will absorb a little bit more or less energy. And this is a magneto-optical effect, so it is related to the two optical constants that I have of the material, N plus and N minus. And now we can also write down the absorption. And actually, if we calculate N plus and N minus, as I will show in a moment, we can calculate the absorption. So we have a different absorption for N plus and N minus. It will mean that I have a different electron temperature, a different heating of the material. And then there is the real part that is the magnetization that is induced by the laser. So this is the inverse Faraday effect, which I mentioned before. Here we have an induced magnetization, and it is nonlinear optics, so it is it depends on E square here. So now we have to look and understand in a moment how these two effects, how they contribute to the all optical switching. Let me also mention, and that was what Bert was showing this morning, that if you go to not gadolinium cobalt, but iron cobalt, not in the amorphous phase, but you make a multi-layer here, you can also do this single-shot toggle switching. So for this material, gadolinium cobalt layers with an exchange coupling at the interface, you can precisely do the same thing as what you have for the amorphous gadolinium iron cobalt, and you can nicely, actually, this is the better plot here, because this is the fluence dependence, but here you can nicely see the toggle switching. And this works with linearly polarized light. So again, this means now that it is a heat-driven mechanism which is similar to what we have for the amorphous gadolinium iron cobalt. I should also mention that there was another paper last year by Vomir, Albrecht and Bigot, Applied Physics Letter, where they had this stack of materials, platinum, cobalt, platinum, and so on. And they nicely also, they could show for this material, single-shot switching. So here one, you see how it works. And then there is an important statement made in that paper regarding the discussion, where does the switching come from and how can we understand it. That they see this with linearly polarized light. So they have a linearly polarized light and they get this switching, which excludes the dichroic mechanism and it also excludes the inverse Faraday effect. So that is what they write. So it is still a question what happens in this material. How can one induce switching there? Let me go now to the modeling that we are trying to do. So in order to get a handle on the fundamental mechanism, we have to do modeling. We have to bring together various fields. Actually, we have to do ab initio calculations. So we have to calculate ab initio. What is the laser-induced magnetization? And then we can, of course, also calculate the dichroic absorption. There are many more things. The electronic heat capacity, there are exchange constants, there is the Gilbert damping that plays a role. This in itself is good, but it is not sufficient because we have to connect the time scales. Yeah, we have our ab initio input, but then we have to go to longer time scales. I'm talking about picoseconds to nanoseconds. So what we need to do is we have to combine with micromagnetic modeling, which then actually also can be done in various different ways. But one of the ways is to use atomistic Landau-Lipschitz-Gilbert equation, or that another form that was also mentioned this morning is the Landau-Lipschitz-Bloch equation. Okay, and not only that, we have to combine with the different heat baths that we have. So we have our different subsystems, we have electrons, we have phonons, and if we want a spin, so we also need either a two-temperature model or a three-temperature model. Okay, and then we can try to describe the experiment. So let us go to the first part here, this part. Actually, dichroic absorption, that is something that nowadays it is quite straightforward to calculate. So what we need is we need linear response theory. So that is Kubo theory. This is the optical conductivity. That is not so difficult. So we can calculate. So here we have the Fermi-Dirac distributions. These are actually is a current correlation. This is the laser frequency here. This is some lifetime of the excited state. And this here, this omega nn prime is the difference between band energies. Okay, so this we can work out and calculate with DFT methods. Of course, they need to be relativistic, but that we have a control over. So then we can calculate the dielectric function, and then we can calculate n plus and n minus. So that are the absorption coefficients for right and left circularly polarized light. If we have these, it is rather straightforward to calculate absorption coefficients, and then we have the helicity-dependent absorption. Okay, so that is what we have to do. This, yes, we know how to do it, and we also know actually that these calculations that they are very accurate and that they describe normally what happens in metals in a quite good way. Good. So that is one thing. Now we have the second thing. This is the inverse Faraday effect. Inverse Faraday effect is much more difficult. It is the previous one was a linear magneto-optical effect, but this one is non-linear. So this is the base. Okay. Yes. Well, the basic equation is M induced is some constant, and then E times E star. That is the basic equation. Now, there was work done by Pitayevsky in the 60s, where he said that actually the inverse Faraday effect constant is equal to the Faraday effect constant. However, there was no quantum theory in there, and it was actually done for a non-absorbing medium. This means that in general, the form is correct. However, it is not the case that these two are connected. So what we need to do is that we need to go to material-specific calculations, which then will help us to do calculations for real materials and then to know how much is the induced magnetization. Okay, so this is basically one can do this with Leo von Neumann's density matrix theory. Here is our Hamiltonian. This is some relaxation here. This is the density matrix, how it evolves in time. Now we have to put into the Hamiltonian, we have to put our light, which is the coupling P dot A, where A is the vector potential of the light. And then we can, so we have then a perturbed density. And then one can calculate this induced magnetization as the trace. This is the operator, L plus 2s, for the magnetization. Actually, this is the orbital magnetization and the spin magnetization. And this is the correction to the density matrix. If you work this out, the equations, they become quite long because it is nonlinear optics. But there is an induced magnetization. Then there is a long constant. And then there is this E0 squared. And these in these constants, again, we have similar quantities as what we have for the linear response. We have the momentum matrix elements and so on. So this now we can calculate. It's a rather long job to program it. But once we have done the DFT calculation, we have our band energies and so on, and we have our the momentum matrix elements, then we can work out these three quantities, and then we have our induced magnetization. Important is that here the operator L plus 2s. So if we do that, and now I write these equations, I write these in a little bit a simpler way, induced magnetization, and now I have an inverse Faraday effect that is it creates a spin magnetization, and the other one it creates an orbital magnetization. This is just some rewriting here. Okay, so what we see is that If we look at only the orbital, this is for palladium platinum here, we can nicely induce a magnetization which is proportional to this constant here. And if you want to compare to the experiment, we have to multiply with the intensity. So what we see is that we have this here. This is nicely anti-symmetric in the helicity. And the orbital part is actually larger than the spin part. What happens is that the spin does not do the same thing as the orbital. It goes in the other direction. So there is an orbital inverse Faraday effect, which was not known before. And it is larger than the spin part. Okay. In general, also what one sees is that if you go to larger spin orbit interaction, like platinum, then you get a bigger effect. Okay, so that we can understand.
You say it wasn't known that you had also orbital effect. I could imagine that if you put spin orbit coupling zero, that you only have the orbital one. Is that?
I have. If you put spin orbit coupling zero, I have some slide, but I take that later on. So if we put spin orbit coupling zero, but also in the calculation, what we have to do is that we set this L zero, and then we have no effect. So if there is no spin orbit coupling, you can say the effect disappears. Yes, does that answer your question?
No. In some sense, I could imagine, because it couples to the helical part of the electric field, that this couples more strongly to the orbit than to the spin. If spin orbit coupling is small, so in that sense, I would not be surprised too much if the orbital effect is larger than the spin part.
Okay.
In a hand waving way.
Let us look at these here. These are elemental ferromagnets. Actually, here we cannot say that spin or orbital is larger or smaller. But there's something else that happens now. If we go to elemental ferromagnets, we have this configuration, magnetization out of plane, and we come with our laser parallel to M. There is something interesting, actually, that now for the ferromagnets, the spin does not show any strong dependence. That is how we got it. I think it was later on was also, actually it came quite soon after us, but it was shown by Frank Freimuth and Yuri Mukhrusov that the spin does not show any strong dependence, spin part of the inverse Faraday effect. But the orbital part is there. If you now add the two contributions, so you have an asymmetry, but it is not, it is no longer the case that we have an anti-symmetry for ferromagnets. Okay, so yes.
A question. So in this case, this orbital part, how is this calculated? Is it by Berry curvature or is it
by the graph? It is completely the equation that is here. It is completely the equation that is here. But what one can do, but we did not do that, but you know that these equations, you can rewrite them as a Berry curvature.
Exactly.
Yeah, we did not do that.
There comes an extra term when you write it as Berry curvature. And there has been a discussion that because in DFT you see a quenching of the L, simply because that extra term is missing. So I was wondering if that has any contribution.
Okay. Yeah. So I have to say, we did not do it in the rewriting as a Berry curvature, although in principle it would be possible to do that. So we have not looked into that.
There may be then another question just to understand better. So here you have spin contribution which is independent on the light polarization.
Yeah.
So you introduce some spin in ferromagnetic metal. Something equivalent to demagnetization or
anything? It might actually look that in all three cases here it is negative, so that it is a negative magnetization. However, the next thing is that if you switch off the laser, it will go away again.
I think the virtual excited state just has a different magnetic moment.
Yes. Yes, if you switch, yes, and then if you switch off the laser, it disappears again.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So what people asked us, and that has, this is a little bit going back to how people first understood the inverse Faraday effect as an optomagnetic field. What we have to do is we have to calculate these constants. We have to put in some intensity, and then we have to take a certain laser energy. And then we can see how much magnetization can we induce in the material. So that is often, it is in normal cases, it's like a few percent. So a few percent magnetization. If you then do a calculation, which is not a completely fair comparison, but what you can do is, what is the applied field that I have to use in order to get a similar induced magnetization? Then it turns out that you actually need quite big fields. Yeah, that if you want to have copper, and you want to induce a magnetization in copper, and you would need a big field to do that. So actually the induced magnetization, it is not large that we can induce by the inverse Faraday effect. But it would correspond to a quite large field. Okay, so this is what we see here. This field, if you want to call this optomagnetic fields, material specific, wavelength dependent, often large if you have materials with a large spin orbit coupling. So basically, what we expect is that the inverse Faraday effect it can contribute to the switching. However, now, not yet. After a few slides, we will put this into the practice. What I thought is interesting is to look at an antiferromagnetic material. Here, this is so. What we can do on the computer, we can make iron an antiferromagnet, and then we can look if we now iron is not ferromagnetic but antiferromagnetic. We can calculate also this inverse Faraday effect constant. It is actually smaller than what we have for the ferromagnet. What we see is, as soon as we have now the anti-ferromagnet, the effect is again anti-symmetric. Yeah, it is anti-symmetric in the helicity. However, if you now look what happens on the different atoms that I have in my iron anti-ferromagnet, then it turns out that this here, this is like summed over the unit cell, and then I get a small effect. But if I look on the individual iron atoms, so now we project on the individual iron atoms, and then actually it turns out that the small effect comes from induced magnetization that is staggered. So I have my inverse Faraday effect on the antiferromagnet, and what I get is I get a staggered magnetization. And then the staggered magnetization is given here. It does not completely cancel. So because it does not completely cancel, there is an effect here. But if you look on the individual elements, the iron atoms in the unit cell, then actually it is a large effect. So the nice thing is that actually if you look here, this induced magnetization, the light has no dispersion over the unit cell. But nonetheless, what happens is I will have a different induced magnetization for the different iron atoms in the unit cell. So that is a little bit similar to what was called the Néel spin torque, where I have an antiferromagnet and I produce a torque that is different on different atoms. Okay, now we can go to iron platinum. That is one of our goals. Here we see that there is an effect. The imparted magnetization is different for spin up and left and right circularly polarized light, and actually we can also calculate on the different atoms what we get. So here we have to see now if we use this here, can we explain the experiments? And for that we have to use this information, the induced magnetization, and we have to combine this now with multi-scale modeling. And this was done with Ulrich Novak and Oksana Shubikalo-Fisenko and also Markus Münzenberg. So what was done is that we take an iron platinum nanoparticle and we do now a macro spin approximation. So I have my nanoparticle that has one spin. And what I can do is I will impart by the laser magnetization. And I can describe that here with Landau-Lifshitz Bloch equation. So important thing is that in there, I can have a longitudinal reduction of the magnetization, which is different from Landau-Lifshitz-Gilbert. So here we have, this is the normal transversal part, but there's also a longitudinal part in this equation that I can use because I have extra induced magnetization. And then from that, one can go to a rate model and then compare to experiment. So what was done by a group of Ulrich Novak, we take now our up initial results. So here we have induced magnetization. So this is the inverse Faraday effect. This is the actually here, these two curves, this is the imaginary part of the optical constant n for sigma plus and sigma minus, they are quite close together. It's a small effect. So if you look now, the MCD effect is around 32 kelvins if I have an electron temperature of around 1100. Okay, small effect, and also inverse Faraday effect is not large, but is a difference between sigma plus and sigma minus. Now we can do simulations. We take this, we take our nanoparticle and we have both, and we do these, but Ulrich Novak do this LLB simulations here, a difference in the imparted magnetization, and then a difference in this electron temperature. And what you can do then, you run the simulation and you look what is the probability that if I have my nanoparticle spin up, that it has switched to spin down, or what is the probability that it is that it stays the same. And this you can do with inverse Faraday effect and MCD, or you can only take MCD. And then you can define for these two cases transition probabilities, down to up, down, down, and so on. So you have these probabilities, and then you can make a stochastic model, as was mentioned by Markus Münzenberg this morning. You would do this repeatedly. And then if you have a certain particle here, it has not switched, but it can with a certain probability, it switches in the next step, and so on. So you can add up these probabilities, and then you can look and compare to experiments. So this was the experiment done by Markus. Number of pulses, the contrast, and what you see is that maybe this is 10, okay, 15 here. We are approaching not a complete contrast, but we have maybe 75% contrast. And then you see, if you now do the simulation, that if you, okay, let's look first here. If you have only magnetic circuit dichroism, there is an effect, but it is very slow. However, with the magnetic circuit dichroism and inverse Faraday effect, we can approach the saturated switched magnetization much faster. So we approach actually in something like 15 pulses, one can come to the state that is not completely 100%, but it is it is saturated. Okay, so the inverse Faraday effect, it helps. It produces switching. And possibly, it's not yet shown, this is still open for question, the inverse Faraday effect could, if it works optimally, we could have switching with a single pulse. But that is still to be seen. Let us now look at a little bit of a different modeling. So we had LLB, now we want to go to Landau-Lifshitz-Gilbert equation. So this is atomistic, this is the atomistic Hamiltonian with classical spins, Heisenberg interaction, anisotropy, and Zeeman field. And now we can take an iron nanoparticle and we take the input, a number of things from up initio, for a moment, and so on. And we can, we provide the up initio and the simulations, they have been done by Sergio Ruta and Roy Chantrell. So let us look at an iron nanoparticle, and we calculate inverse Faraday effect. and the dichroic heating with and this goes then into the Landau-Lipschitz-Gilbert equation, where also the two temperature model that was already mentioned this morning is used, where then the heating goes into this part. But now the difference here is that there is now also the inverse Faraday effect, and that is actually difficult to include in Landau-Lipschitz-Gilbert equation. So they have done that in York, but now we can look at the induced magnetization, and what we can do there is this the time dependence of the laser pulse here, and one can do a kind of experiment on the computer. We can put an extra coefficient in front of it. What does it mean? It means only that I make the inverse Faraday effect stronger. So I can make the inverse Faraday effect like two times stronger, and I can look what it does. And the other thing is that I'm stretching the pulse. So the pulse stretching is in here. There is this tau EFA, so I can make it such that it works longer. Okay. So this is the that is what we try. Now we can do this without inverse Faraday effect. Now I have to see here. Okay, switching probability, laser power. What you see is you reach 50% switching. What does it mean? It only means that I heat up very much and then I cool down, and I have 50% that it is spin up and 50% that it is spin down. Okay, that is the heating, but now we do it with inverse Faraday effect. This is a little bit a difficult plot, so I have to explain what this is. So here, this is the switching probability on this axis. So here, 1 is 100%. And now I have this EFA correction term. So this is when I make the inverse Faraday effect, the induced magnetization, stronger. Okay, that is on this axis. And then on this axis, that if I make the pulse longer, so the inverse Faraday effect is going to work longer. And that is what I can then play with on the computer. And then I have to look. This is zero, but okay. So if the pulses are short, actually does not help so much to make the inverse Faraday effect stronger. But what we can see that this region here I'm going into a large switching probability. So how can I make a large switching probability if I make the pulses longer? And then I can also try to make the inverse Faraday effect stronger. And what we then see is that here we would really approach the deterministic switching. Okay, so there was a discussion or a talk by Yamada this morning, where actually they took long pulses and they saw switching. So what our simulations would say about that is that if you want to reach better switching, it is good to take longer pulses where the inverse Faraday effect can work. You will see, according to this prediction, better switching. Okay, let us now go to the second part of my tutorial, the ultra-fast laser-induced demagnetization. And it has been shown now several times, this plot before, the surprising discovery by the group of Bigot in 96, where they pump nickel metal, and what they see is that with femtosecond Mach, that actually the magnetization drops, and it was much faster than anyone would have expected. It was a quenching in less than 250 femtoseconds. Okay, so we have heard, now something has shifted here probably, but anyhow, so that unfortunately both Eric Baudepaire and Jean-Yves Bigot, they died this year within 1 week from one another. And we are grateful to them for what they have done to the field and also the big stimulation that they have given to the science in this field. So let us now look to the mechanisms. So Bert had a very good tutorial on this morning. So there are several mechanisms that are being discussed. And one of the mechanisms is this Elliott-Yaffet electron phonon spin flip scattering, which then would lead to a fast reduction of the exchange splitting. And this was Bert's work, 2005, 2010, these papers. And what is good in these in the model, microscopic three temperature model, that we have a connection to the three temperature model, and the three temperature model is needed. We need it because the three temperature model, although it is not very precise, but what it does is that it tells us that energy goes into the electrons, and and that energy is distributed to the lattice and to the spins. So in all models, one needs to consider what happens with the energy flow, and that is done in the three temperature model and also in the microscopic three temperature model. The mechanism then is that I have electron phonon scattering with some spin flip probability. And then if that happens, so if a spin-up electron scatters with the phonon and undergoes a spin flip, that then I will have a reduction of the exchange splitting. So if I look at my density of states, they would, because of the spin flip scattering, they would be the difference between majority and minority spin would reduce. Okay, so there was this was in these papers, and then there was extension of this by Schellekens and Koopmans, and also the group in Kaiserslautern had a somewhat different version of but also based on reduction of the exchange splitting, which then goes in stepwise proceeds stepwise in what is called the mu-t model. Then there was another mechanism that on which we worked quite a bit in this paper with Marco Battiato and Carl Zarwa. Here the idea is different. We have our material. Here we have our laser, and it comes into the material. I have nickel on aluminium. And now I will excite electrons, and they will go to SP bands if I excite here in nickel. And what happens is that those electrons, they have high velocities, and they have lifetimes, but the lifetimes, they are also spin dependent. So what can happen then is that the majority electrons that have a high lifetime, they will travel into the aluminium, and they will take away magnetization from the nickel, and it is pushed, so to say, into the aluminium. And you can write this down. This equation, it looks a little bit difficult, but actually what is there, it is a continuity equation. In view of the time, I took away the one that is under it. But what happens is that I have a current term that is actually in this part here. So this part is a divergent of J, and this part is d rho dt, dt. And then there is another term that is a reaction term, where electrons scatter and they disappear from the population. And then there is also a source term. My laser, the material is pumped, and it pumps hot electrons into the material. Okay, so this here one can actually program and work out on the computer. What happens is that if you look at the transport here, that this transport is different from both diffusive and ballistic. And you can see this if you look at this this exponent here, this gamma, because the diffusion here, if I create a hot electron and it is going to diffuse, so I can look how does the position change with time, this average r square of t. And then it can go ballistic. If the electrons just with certain velocity are moving, then I would have gamma is one. or it can be diffusive in this equation here. And then actually what happens is an electron is created and it scatters all the time and it never really moves away. But in this case, if you look at this equation here, then it turns out that it is in between these two regimes. That is why it is called super diffusive regime. Now, there was quite some discussion in the literature about this. I have to say that some papers, where also we were partially involved, they found evidence for this mechanism. Some other papers, not the ones that are here, but actually, so Bert had an APL, I think, where he could not find evidence for this mechanism, and there was also another paper by Gambardella where also they could not see this. So it was, in the last years, it was a topic of discussion. Are these super diffusive spin currents, are they there? And then the next thing that was asked is, yeah, how big are they now? Are they actually small? Maybe they are there, but small, and then they would not contribute. Okay, so that is something that is still being discussed. Let me also mention, if you talk about ultra-fast demagnetization, that you can do quite well Landau-Lipschitz Bloch modeling. This was done here for nickel. Markus Münzenberg was involved here, and also Oksana Shubikalo-Fesenko. And the important thing is that if you use the Landau-Lipschitz Bloch equation, so there is this alpha parallel. Actually, this means that I have a spin dissipation. So this term gives me a spin dissipation, and then I can model for different fluences. I can model the decay of the magnetization, and that works very well. But the big question is, of course, why is there the spin dissipation, and what is the mechanism? Yeah, so this does not, it works well, but it does not tell us what is the mechanism. Okay, and then the fourth theory that I want to mention here, this is by Sandita. This is time-dependent DFT, and I think it was great that TD-DFT has come into this field, because it has really also given a new view on what happens in the ultra-fast demagnetization. So Sandita is going to talk about this after me. These plots are from the paper 2015, where you have a very short pulse. And what is seen then in the calculations that actually there is a rather fast demagnetization, some 10 femtoseconds, and that it is a longitudinal demagnetization, so that the MZ is quenched and MX and MY, they stay actually zero. Okay, so Sandita will tell more about that. Now, having those models, what we set out already a number of years ago, this was done with Carlo Sarva and Marco Battiato. We want to calculate now what is the Elliott-Yaffet spin flip scattering. So what needs to be done is that we have to get a handle on it. How big is it when an electron scatters with a phonon? How much is the spin flip and the demagnetization that we can get? So we did this approach here, which is this is the Eliasberg equation, but it is modified in two ways. That the normal Eliasberg equation from superconductivity is not spin dependent, and we have actually an Eliasberg equation that is a 2 times 2 function, and in here we have the calculated relativistic phonons, relativistic band energies, electron phonon scattering. Okay, so this is now spin dependent, and it is also now energy dependent. And from this here, you can calculate spin resolved transition rates. You have to integrate this, and then you have these two functions here. They are Fermi-Dirac functions. So they would say if I have if I have a certain spin here, spin up in the band, in order that it can scatter, there must also be a hole in the band that has the opposite spin corrector. So here, these are the Fermi-Dirac distributions. However, what we also can do then, they can be thermalized, but we can also have non-thermal Fermi-Dirac distributions and then calculate what is the amount of spin flip scattering that we, the spin flip scattering and demagnetization that we can get. And what we found in these two papers, that there is a contribution from Elliot Yaffet spin flip scattering, but this contribution is large when we have a case where we have a non-equilibrium electron distribution, so that I have the pump laser takes away electrons, and what happens then is that I have many deep holes here, and then I can create many spin flip scatterings. I have to say that, so we did this, and it was independently done by the group of Christian Schneider in Kaiserslautern. The conclusions were the same. Also, Manfred Feenle in Stuttgart calculated it. So what is now the demagnetization that we can get? And I think here we have still a discrepancy with Bert, that Bert does not agree with us. But we did the best that we could do from ab initio. So we have S minus and S plus spin flip probability. And what can happen is that we can have spin increasing spin flips and we have spin decreasing spin flips. So that is the plus and the minus here. And now we can have many spin flips, but they don't change the magnetization. So that is this is the total spin flip probability. And then there is the demagnetization when I have more spin decreasing spin flips and as spin increasing. Okay, so this DS is actually the one that drives the demagnetization. So we can do this calculation. This is this total spin flip probability, and this is this demagnetization ratio. And this we can do for nickel at low temperatures, no demagnetization. Even if you have thermalized nickel, it is quite small. It becomes actually bigger if we put in a non-equilibrium distribution. Okay, so what Bert was doing, Bert uses this quantity here, which is different from our quantity. So this is this also spin flip probability called ASF. And in the calculations of Manfred Feenle, it was quite, it was 0.18 in that direction. So what we got from our calculations is that these numbers are smaller. So if you have thermalized case, actually the demagnetization is quite small. So we would not be able to explain the experiment. Here, the non-equilibrium case is actually better. There we can go to some 17% demagnetization. Okay, so what is important is to look what is the demagnetization ratio. Superdiffusion, I mentioned this. Here we did a calculation to look in which regime are we with the superdiffusion. So this is now, this is a calculation of the equation that was on the previous transparency. And we want to look at this exponent here, this diffusion exponent. And what you see then is that initially we have hot electrons and they travel in the material. And that is in the first step is ballistic. But then they undergo one scattering, two scatterings. And what then happens is that this diffusion exponent becomes time dependent. And in our process, I create the hot electrons in the material. First, they start off ballistic, but then they scatter. And if they have undergone many scatterings, then actually they are diffusive. So we have in the superdiffusion that is ballistic crossing over to diffusive. Okay, so two recent observations of that possibly would confirm that there is spin polarized hot electron transport. So this was the paper that Schellekens, that Bert mentioned this morning, where they had made this special configuration where I have perpendicular magnetization. And then I can create spin-polarized hot electrons here, and they will exert a torque on the bottom layer. Another paper that was by Razdolsky et al., Melnikov, and Uwe Bovensiepen was also involved, 2017, where they nicely showed that what you can do is you pump here, you have now iron, gold, iron, but you excite here standing spin waves through the spin transfer torque. Okay, so that then shows that actually I have spin polarized hot electrons that go through the spacer. There are two posters that give more on the theory, so I have to move on. We were trying to answer the question, how strong are those spin currents? As I said, maybe they are there, but they are so negligible. So this was a project that was done with Martin Eschlimann and Stefan Matthias, and also Bert was involved in this. Nickel on gold, where one pumps the nickel and then one tries to measure the spin in the gold. And what was done in a very clever way is that there is an effect that was developed partially in Kaiserslautern, which is the complex MOAC. So the complex MOAC uses that if I have each material has its own Kerr vector, which I can represent as a vector in two-dimensional space. And now I can adjust my measurements that I am perpendicular to this vector or parallel. And then if I do this in the right way, with polarization analysis, then I can measure only the response from the gold or only the response from the nickel. So that was done in Kaiserslautern. And what they see here for this nickel on gold, so this is the dots here, they are the measurements. What we see is nicely demagnetization in nickel. Actually, it is very fast. So it happens in 40 femtoseconds. 40 femtoseconds demagnetization. And then also the Kerr signal in the gold. What you see here you demagnetize and then the signal in the gold shoots up. So this actually means that I have my spin polarized hot electrons in the gold. And they give this magneto-optical contrast. Now we can also compare to our calculations with superdiffusion, full curves. So this here, this looks quite okay. Actually, here is a difference in this region, which we can discuss. And also the gold is quite well shown, captured. However, there is a difference that I have to point out. So we see that that we have the spin injection into the gold, but there is a factor of two difference here between the theory and the experiment. In our calculation we were assuming there is at the interface that the spin goes through the interface from the nickel into the gold. What is the difference here? That in the experiment, so we would predict a bigger injection of spin in the gold than what is seen in the experiment. And there are several possible explanations why we do not precisely get the same as in the experiment. There are other processes, they would give this difference here, that I do not only have spin injection, but I also have spin flip scattering. And that is what is not in our theory. And then the other thing is that there is spin flip scattering at the interface, where we have no good handle on how to do that. So that is still an open question here, but nonetheless, we have a rather large spin injection efficiency. Now, what I will do is that I will go to the conclusions, the time is over. So if you go back to the inverse Faraday effect, what is now happening and what is progressing is that we have ab initio calculations and we have multi-scale modeling. So now we should be able to do predictions of how can I optimize the all optical switching. So the pulse length was actually predicted by us that it should give a better switching. And then if you go now to the ultra-fast demagnetization, we still have certain mechanisms, several mechanisms that can play a role. The super diffusive transport is there. The interfaces, they are probably more important than what we had in the beginning. So what is needed now is that we have a better modeling of the interfaces to see spin flip scattering at the interfaces. What I mentioned here is this is some recent work, and this is an extension or maybe an outlook for the future, that in fact in many theories, LLG, we have a rigid moment. But some recent work actually has shown that if I think about ultra-fast demagnetization, I cannot no longer treat it as a rigid moment. So that actually what happens on a single atom would be orbital dependent, and that that we would need a more precise modeling for that. This is the outlook, but let me give the acknowledgements and thank to the people here in my group. Ritik has left to Constance, and Karl has already started a few years back in Prague, and the people in blue here with whom we have collaborated. And thank you for your attention.